Today I am determined to see that I am not a body, that I am free. Today I'm determined to see that I am not a body, I am free. Today I am determined to see that I am not a body, I am free. I am as God created me. Today I'm determined to see that I am not a body, I am free. This is the affirmation of the day. Today I am determined to see that I am not a body, that I am free. I am as God created me. Today I am determined to see that I am not a body, I am free. I am as God created me. Again, today I am determined to see that I am not a body, I am free. I am as God created me. And you can add, today I am determined to see that I am not a body, I am free. I am spirit as God created me. Today I am determined to see that I am not a body, I am free. I am spirit as God created me. Today I am determined to see that I am not a body, I am free. I am spirit as God created me. Welcome to the video. What is today? It is the 30th. It is the 30th of July. That means we're headed into early August, and the pressures are extreme now. I've been working with tremendous effort to get everything put back together here. There's been a huge commotion for about a month or so, and everything is very neat. Everything is now very clean, put back just in time, because early August is another date. You see, we don't go by the regular calendar. We go by dates in terms of shifts in the world. Another shift is coming up, August 4th, August 5th. And we have to be at a certain level of readiness at that time. So that's why I'm saying today I'm determined to see that I am not a body, I am free. I am spirit as God created me, which is absolutely true. The one of the final obstacles is our belief that we're a body, and the fact is we have nothing to do with the body. The body actually has absolutely nothing to do with what we are. It tells us absolutely nothing about what we are. Okay, it is just a prop. It is a prop that we are using to deceive ourselves. That's all it is. It has no correlation to what we truly are, our true identity, what we truly are, whatsoever, and it never will. But because we have a severe continuity fear and we're honoring time, we can use the body to help evaporate the continuity problem. At least the body can remain. There's no reason to get rid of the body. Okay, no reason whatsoever. However, we need to be certain. Today I'm determined to see that I am not a body, I am free, for I am spirit as God created me. Early August, we're coming up to early August now. And I'm telling you, shifts are bound to continue to happen in this world. They're happening every single day, minor shifts. Some are bigger than others. And we expect another big one to come. So far, the Holy Spirit, it seems that how I've been interpreting it has been pretty doggone accurate. Talking about the various times that I've said are really important. Something very important has happened then. So we had better have a full steam ahead by August 4th or August 5th. I believe 1st of August is Friday, 2nd, 3rd, so the 4th, Monday the 4th. Probably by the August 4th, I would want to have a full steam ahead here. Under all sorts of distractions, all sorts of pressures, all sorts of attempts to sabotage the momentum at this time. So, I just have to, you know, fortunately it seems as though I almost have lost, but not quite. So today I'm determined to see that I am not a body, I am free, for I am spirit as God created me. Now, we may feel as though we've lost, but the real truth of the matter is that on July 16th, I was able to cross the finish line. So, it may be that I'm just, you know, exhausted after crossing the finish line and not able to function too well. You know, you often see people collapse on a marathon when they cross the finish line. And they're just exhausted and dehydrated, you know, but they finish. And it may take them a while to recover, to recuperate from this. So it's like that. I have to remind myself that I did cross the finish line, which is I was able to get a solid experience of the non-dual absolute position, perspective, abidance. I was able to abide in that. And from there, I was able to see what kind of advice to give the world from that abidance. And I was able to see various pressures and how to deal with them. And then there was one situation that seemed to be a little more difficult than the others. There was just, so I'm just kind of having to let that evaporate a little bit more. Yeah, it's the, anyway, no need to label it. So there has been success. I have been successful. Just as difficult to get a feel for just how great a success that is. Certainly, we're going to have to use affirmations coming up, because the opposition, now let's keep in mind that this realm here is the Luciferian realm, okay? That's what it is. It's the dualistic, spiritually dualistic realm, which comes from the Luciferian idea of being wanting to be greater than God, which then implies a greater and a lesser, which implies levels, which implies layers, which implies realms, which implies hierarchies, which implies effort to go up and judgments, mind, thinking, all thinking, everything. This is spiritual dualism. This world is an extremely spiritually dualistic realm. It is a Luciferian realm through and through. From Jesus' own words, he says, this world belongs to the Prince of Darkness. It is not my kingdom. I'm going to my Father's kingdom. This is a Luciferian realm here. So keep that in mind. It is a spiritually dualistic realm. And there have been great efforts to try and help this realm out and bring light into it, which is to work towards the non-dual perspective, And so I've been able to do that, fortunately. Hasn't been easy. And the Luciferians will do anything and everything to try and trip you up, to try and discourage you, to slander you, to create scandal for you, to do everything, which is why we need to forgive, and even forgive the Luciferians, because we too have been caught up in that agenda. It seems very intriguing, like, hey, there's a place that's beyond everywhere. Hey, let's see if we can find it. And that gets you into the trouble, dualistic trouble, because then you lose a sense of just one family, oneness, one family, and you start judging, and you start saying, well, am I higher than you? You're lower than me. You're closer to this new realm. I'm farther away. You're more worthy of it. I'm less worthy. You see, all this judgment enters in when we have this notion that there's some other place to be other than everywhere. And this is the Luciferian whim, actually. And so we've all got caught up in this, and we have to get free of it. But this place here is a strong bed of Luciferianism. And you've had this tremendous influx of Luciferians into this world over the last 50 years or so, especially maybe the last 35. And so it's going in the wrong direction. It's going towards a spiritual stone age here. But it doesn't seem that way, because the Luciferians, their idea is that there is closer and better, and they're here to bring closer and better to us, you see. And everyone says, wow, I got an opportunity to get closer to God, to get nearer to God, to get better, you know. So to them, they think it's a golden age that's come. You know, it's a spiritual stone age, because salvation comes from being able to shift your attention to the absolute non-dual abidance. That's the only way you get salvation, right? is a shift of attention, not a doing of any type except just a shift of attention right now, this instant, in other words, not a time-based adjustment. It's not an adjustment, it's a shift of attention, just looking from looking at a hallucination to looking at the way things actually are, the way it actually is, the way it actually is. And I asked a question in the last video, a very good question you should ask yourself. Is Jesus closer to God than we are? Or if whatever your religion happens to be, is Krishna closer to God than we are? Is so-and-so Buddha closer to God than we are? Is Sri Anandamayi Ma closer to God than we are? Whoever you want to view as someone superlative, okay, superlative, spiritually superlative, are they closer to God than we are, is the question. And of course, the answer is absolutely not. Absolutely not. There is no closer and further away to the allness, the one family. Just as this is 100% purely abiding in pure spaciousness, it's not 99.9%, it's 100%. All is 100% abiding in the pure spaciousness, which is God. So there can't be any greater or lesser. There can't be any closer or further away. God is everywhere equally. So how can there be any such thing, situation, as closer? There cannot. Just to believe it is spiritual dualism, is Luciferianism. And that won't save you. It will embroil you in death, is what it will really do. In fact, you will think that death is what gets you closer. You see, you end up believing that that dying at just the right moment, just the right place, just the right time is the ultimate way to get closer to God, which is total insanity. And the Luciferians insist that you have to die. You have to die. That is just, you have to learn how to die in just the right way, and then that will somehow boost you into a higher realm, all this stuff. No, you don't need any death at all. You can't get closer to God because you can't get further away. Okay, this is non-dual talk, and I'm getting better and better at it here as I catch my breath. This is what Jesus teaches, actually, is non-dual, absolute perspective without any exception whatsoever. And this may seem difficult, but it's not that difficult, actually. If you bring in the principle of pure spaciousness, which was brought to me by the great guru Longchenpa, a great radical Dzogchen, got a little sting there, teacher Longchenpa, okay? Pure spaciousness, zero dimensionality, is God. It's absolutely true. Everywhere equally, there's nowhere where this pure spaciousness is not. Now, again, if you went on a search to find something, somewhere that was not in pure spaciousness, would you ever succeed? Would you ever succeed? And the answer is no. What could you find that was not in spaciousness? Right? Just offhand, of course, if there was no spaciousness at all, there wouldn't be anywhere to find anything. Right? But be that as it may, pure spaciousness is boundless. So no matter what you find, no matter what you find, it is 100% in pure spaciousness right now, always and forever. There's no possibility of escaping from that fact whatsoever. Only in a hallucination could it seem possible. Nothing else. Not in reason won't tell you that. It's only in a hallucination could it seem even possible. And we are definitely hallucinating, as Jesus says. We are hallucinating. We're seeing that which is not there. That's an hallucination, right? We're seeing layers and levels. There are no layers, there are no levels. There's only zero dimensionality, pure spaciousness. There are no layers, there are no levels. There's only pure spaciousness. There's only the zero of pure spaciousness. So today I am determined to see that I am not a body, I am free, for I am spirit as God created me. So we continue to bring forth the non-dual absolute perspective, which is salvation. which is our attention making this easy, gentle shift, ultimately. Now, you may do it long before I do it. That is quite possible. It's that simple. For some reason, most of us are reluctant to do it, and that's okay, but you have to keep trying. You have to keep on reminding yourself how easy it is. There are no layers, there are no levels to get through, so you don't need any time to do it. It doesn't take any time to do it, actually. You might say the shift may take in just a moment. One moment you're seeing one way, next moment you're seeing, there are no layers, there are no levels. Everything is equally present in pure spaciousness, always has been and always will be. Everything is perfect. As Sri Ananda Maimai used to say, everything is perfect, just as it is. They say, hey, how come you don't help out and do this and blah, blah, blah? And she goes, everything is perfect just as it is. Everything is absolutely perfect just as it is. And if I try to help you do this, you're going to think it isn't. And that's going to actually strengthen dualism. Just like I said, I thought I was in this pit, and I reached my hand up to Jesus. I said, help, 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 pull me out. Jesus didn't do anything. Just looked at me calmly. And I was so furious. I said, I lost my faith over that, you know? And then I realized if he would have reached down and pulled me out, I would have believed the pit was real. I would have believed my hallucination is real. There is no pit. There is no pit. There is no depth. It's just like an image of a pit. And looking at the image, you forget it's an image. It's not real. You think there's depth there. And so he cannot pull you out, because that would make things way worse. You think you are trapped. You think everyone else is trapped too. But keep in mind, everyone else you see in that pit, you're looking down the pit, you see everyone down there. They're not in the pit either. Nobody's in the pit, because there isn't any. There's a hallucination of a pit, but there's no pit. The power of hallucination is very frightening, actually. We can deceive ourselves to the utmost in that way. In fact, we have deceived ourselves. Now, obviously, spiritual dualism is not going to understand this at all and saying, wow, what's the use? I don't understand at all. But this is the truth, and speaking it, it gradually seeps into you. It gradually seeps into you, just like. And you wear away, you gradually evaporate the continuity fear. Because the continuity fear is what petrifies us. We're saying, wow, I don't want to drop my hallucination. Well, we can have a happy hallucination, actually. But ultimately, we don't want to drop our hallucination. Too frightening. We think that nothing's there, you know. If we don't see a pit, well, there's nothing there. No, there's no hallucination there. But we think hallucination is reality. So we think by dropping hallucination, we'll drop reality, and we'll just be in a complete abyss. We're not aware that we're hallucinating. We're barely aware of it. And so we think it's reality. What we're perceiving is reality. It's not. We're not seeing God is the problem. God is reality. We need to see God everywhere. There's only God everywhere, pure spaciousness everywhere, ultimately. But we can continue to see apparent form. It's just that it's all has the exact sameness of abidance in pure spaciousness, 100%. And it's completely pure. The pure spaciousness is absolutely pure. The appearance of any form does not taint the fact that it's 100% purely in pure spaciousness, you see. So what we need to see is the purely in pure spaciousness of the situation, of what appears to be an existential situation out there surrounding us. We need to actually recognize that. Now, this is not something that can be perceived through our senses, right? How can our senses perceive pure spaciousness? It's a spiritual recognition that takes place. This is called the vision of Christ. Vision of oneness, vision of Christ, purely abiding in pure spaciousness. Everything equally is the same. There's absolutely nothing to. So it means everyone is abiding, purely abiding in pure spaciousness, 100% the same as everyone else. There's no difference at that fact. No difference in this fact at all. And this fact is primary. This fact is primary. Everything else is an hallucination, actually. So there may be some that are hallucinating severely, yes. And practically, there needs to be some practical recognition of this, see. And this is where it gets confusing for everybody. But we don't need to struggle with that. We don't need to struggle with that. Later. First we have to let the facts sink in. Deal from a standpoint of facts first. So I don't know when this will surface for me, this recognition will surface. I don't know. I've been working at it. And it's bound to surface. But I couldn't tell you right now when. I don't have any sense of when it's going to surface. It's just the continuity fear, tends to pull it down and keep it from surfacing. I do have to say that everything, all my surroundings, everything, are way better than they've ever been. So the situation is set up for something to surface, I would say. But do not get frustrated or lose your patience or struggle when it hasn't surfaced. Because it's a struggle not to. I'm really furious today, like, wow, I can't believe it hasn't surfaced yet. Because I'm really in desperate need for it to surface. So I ask Holy Spirit, what are you doing? Come on, we're under the gun here for sure. But, it hasn't surfaced yet. But continue to keep reinforcing, and keep your spiritual practice going at all costs. Doesn't matter what the results seem to be. You don't know how severe the continuity problem is. You do not know. They say, I don't have a karma problem. I have a continuity problem. The karma problem has no value to me. But the vision of oneness, only the vision of oneness has value for me, because it solves the one and only problem that I have is a continuity problem. I do not have a karma problem. It's impossible to have a karma problem. But I do have a severe continuity problem. The karma problem has no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. This is true. Of course we can't have karma, because nothing has ever happened that wasn't our choice that it happened. That there's never been anyone victimized, ever. Never. Never, never, and there never will be. Everything has been our choice. Now, we've made some pretty amazing choices, haven't we? Because we believe that would help us adjust to this new realm that we believe exists, which it doesn't exist. And so we may have asked for all sorts of experiences that seem to be victim experiences, but we certainly asked for them 100%. Nobody forced anything upon us whatsoever. Never has never happened. So, if that's the case, how could there ever be karma? Or someone did something to you that was bad, that you didn't ask for, or someone did something that's good, that you didn't ask for? How can you build good karma, or how can you build bad karma, when everything, without exception, is a mutually collaborative adventure and choice? It is impossible. Totally impossible. So there is no karma. However, we've been believing that there is. Because we've been using guilt to try and make ourselves superior to others and say, oh, you forced something upon me, you're guilty, you're bad, I'm higher than you, you're lower. So we can get a sense of higher and lower, thinking that was getting us closer to this entering this new realm where we're going to prove we're greater than God. That would be the proof that there's some realm beyond God that God isn't telling us about or doesn't even know about. And once we reach it, we'll find out, oh my gosh, this is greater than God, we're greater than God. So of course we're using all these tricky techniques. Guilt is a very big one. we ask for something, experience, and then we say, I didn't ask for that experience. You forced it on me. You're guilty. You're bad. Therefore, I'm good. Therefore, I'm greater than you. I'm higher than you. I'm closer to this new, this super realm, the realm beyond God. I'm closer to it, and it gives you a sense of getting closer to it. And so it builds your, quote, ego. The ego is just the hopes and motivation that we carry to reach this greater realm that we believe, we hope exists. So we have to keep building our ego up to keep a sense that we're moving towards it and having success. So we use all these very nasty, vicious techniques to keep building our motivation and believe we're succeeding. We're succeeding, we're succeeding. I'm getting higher. Oh, you did something terrible to me. You're lower, you're lower, you're lower. That means I'm higher, I'm higher, I'm higher. And you have to help me now because you did something bad to boost me up even higher, things like that. This is the Luciferian realm, where all of this. The Luciferian realm believes in victimization. It's absolute number one thing. When you come to a Luciferian realm, you see the belief that there's such a thing as victimization. That's a total giveaway that it's a Luciferian realm. Okay, now, here, there was a great effort to lift this false dualism up, you know, to start getting free of it. Start working through a continuity problem. So there was this big push to bring in forgiveness. Forgiveness, forgiveness, forgiveness. And that is, what you say is not forgiving another for what they did to you. It's forgiving yourself for asking for these experiences. Because you were not quite aware why you were doing this. You know, you say, why am I asking for all these horrible situations? Because I believe, you know, it's dualism. We believe that's helping us somehow get closer to something, to succeed in some way. And of course, there's no closer to God or success or anything at all. We're already 100% abiding in purity, complete purity of pure spaciousness. We are 100% purely abiding in the pure spaciousness. All is already, always. No way to get out of that at all, ever. So what success do we need? We don't need any. So we forgive ourselves for being so stupid, for being so whimsical, for being so frightened and confused that we ask for these terrible circumstances that we put ourselves under. And we all certainly have done that much. And I'm no exception. I put myself through horrendous circumstances, thinking that somehow was getting me closer. So I certainly was a dualist, as virtually everybody here is, needing to take the spiritual path to begin to recognize the true non-dual absolute truth. Non-dual absolute truth. You can't get closer to God. So we don't need a path to get closer to God, do we? That's why I say there is no path. That's why they say there is no path. There is no path to get closer to God whatsoever, none whatsoever. So really, the path is to recognize that there is no path. We're on the path to recognizing that there is no path. For anyone. Nobody needs it. No one needs it. Why do we hallucinate terrible circumstances, terrible, you know? Well, so we can believe that there's better, that there's something closer to God. By hallucinating something, we say, wow, that's really, really far away from God. At the same time we're believing that, we're believing, wow, I know I can get a lot closer to God than that. A lot closer than that. You see, this is strengthens delusion. Strengthens delusion. Sickness is the same way. Wow, this is, you know, this is really so sick. It's definitely, you know, is not pure at all. Very impure, very sick, very far away from where I want to get to go, which means, oh, there must be a lot of improvement I can make from this. A lot of improvement. This is the craziness that we're caught in the Luciferian realm here. We're not caught in it. We're deceived. We are deceived. And we have a severe continuity fear. We're afraid to let go of it. but we're working on it, right? You have to work on it. All the teachers say, you have to spend your entire life working on this issue situation. You have to. That's your career. That's your hobby. It's your passion. It's your career. It's your number one interest. Everything else takes a back seat. Now, you can have a family, a career, whatever. That's in the back seat, though. That's in the back seat. Always. Always in the back seat. You, the driver in the front seat, you have to, all of us have to, take the path to recognizing there is no path. Have to. Otherwise, we will simply remain in this vicious, vicious place. Luciferian realm is absolutely vicious. Using guilt, attack, victimization, death, confusion, depression, all the hideous stuff that we experience, severe anxiety, fear, vulnerability, we will simply keep amplifying that, keep playing with that, keep playing with all those parameters in very nasty ways. Just look at history, how nasty history has been, and know that the future is just as nasty, if not more so. If not more so. So again, this effort has to be in the front seat, and everything else has to be back seat. You can't let them get in the front seat. They try to get in the front seat? No. Get back in the back seat. You've got to put one of those police windows up, you know, with bar, cage and wire and bars and stuff, so they can't get through to you in the front seat. It's like that. You're carrying these crazy lunatics, insanity in the back seat. You know, insanity's in the back seat. Keep insanity in the back seat. Keep insanity in the back seat. Let me boost this up a little bit. Keep insanity in the back seat. All right. See if I can get this to behave. Not really. That's okay. Take a break. There you go. Keep insanity in the back seat. So, living in this Luciferian realm, or at least appearing here, having an appearance here, at least appearing to have an appearance here, is very, very, very difficult and unpleasant, can be. And this realm is subject to tremendous shifts, vicious shifts. Because everybody is frantically trying to get closer to the goal. Now, what is the goal? The goal is not really God. They call it God. A lot of people call it God. The goal is really to reach a realm that is greater than God, a realm beyond God. That's really the goal. That's the Luciferian goal, to reach a realm beyond God that God didn't tell us about or we don't know. Doesn't know about, where we from there will rule over God, rule over, will be the new God, will be greater than God. That's the Luciferian agenda. So we're pursuing that pell mell, and the world is, you don't know what the shifts. I mean, I've been tipped off to various situations, and what I've seen is extraordinary. What I saw in a dream this morning was so extraordinary, I have a hard time even explaining it. It had to do with planes in the sky. And these formations of planes were just everywhere in the sky was full of planes, of massive military planes that looked like a very advanced type of plane, flying objects, doing intricate maneuvers in the sky. And on the ground were official military police, civilian control, you know, official vehicles everywhere. Everywhere. Just everything was, you know, the lights are going around, the sirens, the lights, the blockades, just like something, you know, unbelievable had happened. And you look up at the sky, and say, what is going on? And there was like a fleur-de-lis tracery in the sky. And I said, look at that, what is that? It's delicate and beautiful, but is this what is a fleur? It's a fleur-de-lis, which is a three-pronged thing, which is a trident, which is 1, 2, 3. I've told you that this symbology around the trident about 1, 2, and 3, I believe it's World War 1, World War 2, World War 3, something like that. It was in the sky, this trident. And so I asked Spirit what's going on. He said, there's three, this is three. Well, I guess I didn't need to ask anymore. This is three. So there's shifts always happen in the Luciferian realm. It's a completely unstable realm. A little squirrel. In fact, any belief that there is a realm is unstable. That's delusion, that's hallucination. There's no layers or levels in reality whatsoever. No layers or levels whatsoever. No layers or levels whatsoever. So to believe that we're in a realm, that itself is hallucination. That itself is. There's the squirrel in the tree, and suddenly the cat is here, ferociously focused on it. Maybe that's a sign. Something in the sky, focusing on something up there, focusing on it. In the Luciferian realm, there's always shifts, there's always turmoil, there's always layers and levels, the appearance of layers and levels, up and down, constant turmoil, always. So to expect anything other than that is madness, absolute madness. You cannot purify hallucination in terms of this Luciferian realm. You cannot purify it. It's like time itself is the contaminant. How can you purify it? This is something that the world is caught up in, thinking that they can make it better. They can make it better. Now, you cannot make what's impossible better. You cannot make what's impossible better. There's no better to it. Because all that really is making, saying we're getting closer. We're getting closer. There is no closer. It just actually reinforces delusion. When you try to say, well, we're making the world a better place, we're making happier, better, safer, less vulnerable, curing illnesses, doing all this stuff. What we're saying is we're making progress. We're getting closer to our goal. This is simply reinforces duality. Reinforces duality. As Jesus said, I need do nothing. I need do nothing. I know nothing. I need do nothing. There's nothing I need to know. There's nothing I need to know. There is nothing I need to know. There is nothing I need to know. Okay, this is another great affirmation. There is nothing I need to know. There is nothing I need to do. There is nothing I need to know. There is no such thing as closeness to God. There's nothing I need to do. There is nothing I need to know. There's nothing I need to do, and there's nothing I need to know. I can turn that around in some phrase. There's nothing I need to do, there's nothing I need to know. The presence of God is purity's show. Is purity's show. The presence of God is purity's show. There's nothing I need to do, there's nothing I need to know. The presence of God is purity's show. Yeah. There's nothing I need to do, there's nothing I need to know. The purity of God is, the presence of God is purity's show. Okay, let's look at this. There's nothing I need to do. I'm already 100% purely abiding in pure spaciousness of God. So there's nothing I need to do to get there. I'm already there. There is no there. There's no way I cannot be there. There's nothing I need to do. To know something. I'm already exactly where I need to be without any other possibility. So what do I need to know about that? What do I need to know? If something's already the case, and there's no way it cannot be the case, I can't leave God. I can't leave pure spaciousness. I can't go into it. I'm already there. There's no place I can leave. But what do I need to know in terms of that? There's nothing I need to know. There's nothing I need to do. There's nothing I need to know. The presence of God is purity's show. Nothing I need to do. There's nothing I need to know. The presence of God is purity's show. in the Luciferian dualistic realm. Everyone's saying, wow, you know, we're cooperating, working together, we're helping out, we're making progress. We think things are getting a little better here. We're trying to you know, become more compassionate, more helpful, and help people, you know, up from poverty. We're trying to bring them here, you know, this way and make things better. We're making the world a better place. Let's fix this, let's fix that. But all of this activity is the activity of overlooking where we actually are. Where am I really? We need to stop. Everyone needs to stop. Say, wait, where am I really? Now, you may think the person who's very poor and suffering, you know, why? You say, well, that's an expression of their belief that they look at this symbol, this play here, this hallucination, and say, wow, there's a lot of progress I can make from here. A lot of progress I can make from here. So they're honoring time to an extreme extent. Say, wow, there's a lot of progress. I know I can get a lot closer to God, a lot better, a lot closer. You know, make a lot, locks them into a lot of time, a lot of time. So, but the fact is, I need to do nothing. I don't need to do anything I don't need to know. I need do nothing, I need not know. The presence of God is purity shown. So wherever we are, the fact is, right now, there's nothing I need to do, there's nothing I need to know. The presence of God is purity shown. This is true for all. No matter what the appearance seems to be, this is true for all. Equally true for all. Equally true for all. So does that mean that somebody in a garbage pile, scavenging food with the seagulls, can realize that this instant? Absolutely. Just the same as somebody in a mansion on a hill with 20 cars in their garage. Exactly the same. Zero difference. And the realization that is, I'm not a body, I'm free, I am God, I am as God created me. Today I'm determined to see that I am not a body, I am free. I am spirit as God created me. Then you realize that these are just props. All bodies are just props to give the illusion of farther and closer, illusion of progress, because the vulnerability of the body makes it seem that progress is essential, right? And look at the progress we've made. Look at the nice houses, look at the streets, look at everything we've done to make the body more comfortable. And we're using the body as a symbol reaching the higher realm. It symbolizes the higher realm, the body. And so what we can do to get closer to the perfect body situation, we think that's getting us closer to this higher realm. There is no higher realm. There are no realms at all. There's only the oneness. There's the one family of the oneness, of one family purely abiding in pure spaciousness, which is God, without any possibility that could ever be otherwise. So there's only this one eternal life, the situation of one eternal life, always and everywhere. And the play of appearances are simply one condition of simply the play of appearances. That's all. There's nothing other than that. We can just enjoy the light show. You know, the light show. We can just enjoy all the play of appearances. It has absolutely nothing to do with our identity. With, you know, doesn't have any effect on truth whatsoever. But because we identify with the body, it makes it quite difficult to see what's going on here, because we feel that the success of the body is a sign of our success towards happiness, which is to get into this higher realm. And of course the problem is, there is no higher realm. There are no realms at all. And then we say, what do we do with the body then? That's the question. The body's useless to us, actually. They're completely useless except as a communication device. And so we should, as much as possible, simply use the body as a communication device. De-emphasize the physicality of the body. That is super important. Super important. Super important. It might be a good thing if everyone was wearing like this sort of cloaks or something that you know, just you get this, no, just an amorphous out, you know, no outline of the body at all. De-emphasize the outline of the body entirely. Just wear a bag, as it were. Wear a bag. Everyone should be wearing bags, actually. But in the Luciferian realm, that's blasphemy. It's heresy. Everyone here is wearing like skin-tight leotards, trying to show off every bit of their body possible. You know, it's just like everyone's so proud of, look at the success my body is having, which symbolizes the belief they're having success in getting closer to this so-called hidden realm. The hidden realm, which doesn't exist, actually. The hidden realm that doesn't exist. So in the Luciferian realm, the body is emphasized. The outlines of the body, the musculature of the body, the qualities of the body, the look of the body, to adorn it, to put makeup on it, to try to make it look beautiful, to try to showcase it, to show off. Like, no, we should have, you know, just simple, 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 simple. Ultimately, it would be better for everyone to be wearing bags, actually. Bag, just one piece bag. Maybe we'll all wear burqas, you know, men and women, actually. You know, actually, men should be wearing bags, too, you know, because they're showing off all their musculature, too. The metrosexual type of, you know, men are like, look at me, I'm so, you know, neat, and I'm a very feline, everything's perfect, look at this. No, that's not it. So, and yeah, they're wearing leotards and bike suits and trying to, look at this musculature, look at this body, isn't this amazing? Maybe everybody should be wearing burqas, actually. Let's everyone wear burqas. That would actually help out immensely. But in the Luciferian realm, that's an absolute anathema, you see? It's an absolute anathema. Absolute anathema. And of course, they're furious about women wearing burqas because they want to emphasize women above all other bodies, because they think that women's bodies, because they're, you know, smoother skin, you can paint makeup on better, the hair's lusher and longer, the fashion seems to look better on women, they can, you know, the adornment and everything, so you can make the body seem even more attractive if you highlight females. Highlight females. So the idea of covering that up with a burqa is like just, you know, like a red rag to a bull to the Luciferians. Like a red rag to a bull. It just freaks them out entirely. They want to wipe that out entirely. But as I say, to be fair, let's everybody wear burqas. That's actually would be a great thing for everyone. But, you know, women in Rome do as Rome do to a certain extent. So what's important is just stay basic, stay plain. De-emphasize the body in your mind, in your attitude. Be meek, be humble. Be meek, be humble. And keep in mind that when you do that, those who are on the path to recognize there is no path will certainly have a great deal of appreciation for you. Certainly have a great deal of appreciation. When I see someone who's truly modest, I see them in a modest way, I say thank you. My heart says thank you very much. It's rare you ever see anyone like that. Especially where I live. Where I live, it's like this insane body culture. People are just so completely into it. They're just freaks, actually. But occasionally you see someone who's just plain. You can tell. I'm, you know, they say, my body is, doesn't matter how I look. It's only, you know, what matters is salvation from this Luciferian realm. And you see that, and you just recognize, you say, wow, thank you very much. Thank you very, very much. I appreciate it. But it's like one in a million, almost. And there's others that try to go the full, you know, hippie look with the huge, just the look. But they're drawing attention to themselves, too. They're really drawing attention to themselves by doing that. So just don't draw attention to the body. I mean, I just try to fit in where I live, but in a super, just, you know, basic, plain, drab way. You know, pretty much drab most of the time. Just look drab, and just look in a way that you think people just overlook you, your body. Don't even notice you. Don't even notice you. And just, you know, I kind of walk with my head, you know, meekly walk with the head down. Try not to look at other people. I try not to look at other people when I'm out. Just ignore them. If there's someone who you can tell is meek and humble and modest, you know, then, you know, give them some love. You know, give them some love and say, and smile, and you can and reinforce and let them know there's a sense of appreciation for that. Because it's super helpful. There's nothing more distracting than bodies, than putting our attention onto bodies. Nothing more distracting than that. It's ruinous for us. Absolutely ruinous. Ultimately, just a plain, like, you know, just a plainness in the dress. Just a plainness like this. You know, no pattern, no colors, no, just plain would be very good. Now, in the times I've seen the Vision of Oneness, I actually saw all these people. But how did I see them? Kind of like, I just saw the outlines of all these bodies, and it was just in this kind of a whitish color, like this color. And I didn't notice any features of any bodies at all. The bodies were just kind of this basic heterogeneous outline of just a basic place marker for a body, so to speak, and they just had this sort of white light around all of them. And you couldn't see any features, any ornamentation, any hair color length, or anything. It was just sort of like this beautiful light was there around all bodies. But without distinguishing, one body was not distinguishable from another whatsoever. I saw millions of bodies, but not one was distinguishable from another. All the same. So we can still be aware that there are bodies here, but no distinguishing one from another whatsoever in the Vision of Oneness, from what I understand. But it's absolutely incredible in this realm how ignorant we are of what helps us towards success. The Luciferian realm is a realm where we strive for 100% ignorance as to how to drop this realm, how to recognize it's an hallucination. We try for 100% ignorance. That's our goal here. What else can we do? Since there isn't any realm, hidden realm, and we're in search of it, we believe there is, what else can we do but play the game of 100% ignorance? Which is impossible, because the truth is within us. But we certainly try to be 100% ignorant about what would be helpful to wake up from this dream. Oh, I have no idea. What dream? What are you talking about? I don't know anything about that. And so we try to, as much as possible, emphasize all that is bad, all that is delaying, everything that keeps us bound to this insane search. We highlight and emphasize that. And the West especially has embraced that wholeheartedly with the start of the Age of Enlightenment, which is actually the Age of Unenlightenment. Through on so many steps, French Revolution, the secularization of society, the pushing science and secular humanism to the front, and then basically this materialistic consumerism. On and on and on and on and on. The West has spearheaded this Luciferian agenda in the world. And we're all supposed to be peacocks showcasing, you know, how beautiful can we make the body, you know. How attractive can we get it? How can we get everybody fixated on bodies? which is 100% Luciferian agenda. It is. It's Antichrist. Antichrist for sure. But I'm just bringing this up so we're just, there's an awareness, a clarity about it. I mean, I've been there too, been there, done that too. We all have. At some point I went through this phase too of like, hey, what is that like? What is it like to really dress the body up? You know, that's kind of weird. It's like, huh, is that where it's at? You know, is that where it's at? And then said, well, you know, no, that's not where it's at. Not really. Not really. But we certainly don't want to institutionalize it. We don't want to institutionalize it, but we have. We have institutionalized it. And the Luciferians think that going back to wearing this like a, you know, like a one-piece bag, a colorless bag, neutral bag to completely de-emphasize the body, they view that as like the worst regression possible, like the most horrible idea possible. That just shows you how far off base they are, really. Because that's one of the most helpful steps that we could take. The more we de-emphasize the body in the world, the better it is for us. And the closer we get to recognizing where we really are. See, we just simply refuse to recognize where we are, where everything is. Where is everything? Everything is in God. See, we refuse to recognize that. You don't get closer to God by dressing like a peacock, or you don't get closer to God by focusing on the body. Now it's true you don't get closer by dressing down too, but you can't. There's no such thing as closer. There's no such thing as closer. But since we have chosen the body as to be the hero of this dream, the hero that lets us know how successful we're being in this search for this hidden realm, it's very important then to de-emphasize the body. De-emphasize. De-emphasize the body. This, you know, it just need to be aware of this. Don't think it's going to happen. Don't think that it's going to happen. But we can to a certain extent. Yeah. If you try to do that, if you walk around and if everyone walked around the West in burqas, they would be, you get fired from your job, right? People would look at you like you're a crazy cult. You know, it completely would upset their sensibilities of the West. It just drives them nuts. Because this is the heart of Luciferianism here. And at all costs, they want to emphasize the female form. At all costs. You know, it's the most important agenda they have. It's super important. Get everybody looking at bodies as much as possible. And seeing how important the body is, how beautiful the body is. You know, that kind of thing. That's the Luciferianism right there, 100%. So we're just letting this sink in, letting it sink in. It's like, wow, this is interesting. It's interesting to hear this. Interesting to say it in our society, isn't it? Our society is a lunatic asylum. All dualism is a lunatic asylum. But it's especially potent here in the West. Especially potent. And you just don't hear this sort of talk in the West at all. And it makes the Luciferians, you know, rabid. They turn into rabid dogs. Rabid dogs. It just blows their minds completely. They can't even think, you know, they can't even take one step in that direction. Now, course, we people tend to play out, honoring time, they play out a lot of, act out a lot of stuff. Okay, understandable. Have to forgive that, have to forgive. So it's a forgiving attitude. But we have to admonish us also. Admonishing is very, very important. That's the purpose of the presence of God's grace in this world, is to admonish us and to lead us into forgiving ourselves for being so stupid, to drop, ultimately drop the hallucination, accept the intermediate step, the vision of Christ, which is the, we realize everything is purely abiding, 100% purely abiding in the pure spaciousness that is God. Everything is purely abiding right now without anything needing to happen whatsoever. Nothing. And doesn't matter what happens, nothing is happening to this fact. So as far as for this step, as far as this fact is concerned, there's absolute stillness. There's no change whatsoever in this fact. As absolute stillness means, right? Absolutely no change, it would be absolute stillness, right? Well, this fact does not change in the slightest bit. So if we make this recognition primary, our experience, primary experience would be this absolute stillness. Peace beyond understanding. And this is the non-dual absolute abidance, is to abide in this absolute stillness as your primary experience. And everything else is just like little shadows, shadow dancing, but you know, it doesn't have any effect on your primary experience. This is all that we're, this is all that we're going towards. That's it, that's all. It's very reasonable, very sane. Okay, I won't make this one so long, but I'll probably do another one after this so you can, you know, just have, feel like you're not caught in an endless video. And, because I try to say as much as possible every video, I try to make all the taboos, try to push through all the madness, bring up stuff that other people, others will not say here, because out of fear, they say, I don't dare say that. It's too frightening. Just so you realize that the non-dual position, the absolute position, is a position of fact. It's a position of fact. It's an unassailable fact, actually. You can't get closer to God because you're already 100% purely abiding in God. There's no closer, and thus there's no farther away, is there? We're perpetually swimming in God. All is perpetually swimming in the ocean of God. There isn't any other ocean. There isn't any other place. And so, there's nothing I need to know, nothing I need to do. Nothing I need to do, nothing I need to know. I'm swimming in the presence of the purity. Of the purity show. Swimming in the presence of this purity show. There's nothing I need to do, there's nothing I need to know. I'm swimming in the presence. All is swimming in the presence of this purity show. There's nothing anything needs to do. There's nothing anything needs to do, to know. All is swimming in this purity show. Okay. So it's more potent if you make the affirmations for all, actually. Way more potent. So there's nothing the all needs to do. There's nothing the allness needs to know, for all is swimming in the presence of this purity show. This purity show, there's just this purity show. That's all, it's the only show there is this purity show. It's the only show there is this purity show. The only show that there is. Okay, alright, so we need to make tremendous acceptance and recognitions, and we are very great. That's it for this one.